Monday morning. My name is Eric Villang. I'm the director of the Center for Center for Society and Genetics, and it's my pleasure to welcome Dr. Patrick Allard, or Allard, to the center. Patrick did a PhD in biology at McGill University, and then moved on to a postdoctoral fellowship at Harvard, and is doing two concurrent postdoctoral fellowships, one in the lab of Dr. Cliff Tabin in developmental biology, and one in the lab of Dr. Monica Colaiacovo in toxicology. And what's interesting about this is it's really about trying to bring the aspects of developmental biology, toxicology, and per a number of conversations we've had, societal aspects to the study of environmental disruptors. So, welcome, and without further ado, we'll let you explain to us all about toxics.
Should save that for the end. Just have to, clapping by the end. Thank you very much, Eric, for the introduction. And actually, I really want to thank all of you for the warm welcome that I've received both this time and also back in September when I came for an informal visit. It's always been a pleasure. So as you may be able to infer from the title and also from the picture, actually maybe, yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, don't fall asleep. I'm using model systems to better understand the relationship between our environment and our health. But before I get into the science, I really wanted to spend a few slides to explain what are the overarching questions that guided me through my postdoc and will hopefully guide me through my career as well. So I'm interested in understanding how, as people, so as individuals or as a society, we transform our environment, and how in turn this transformed environment can actually affect us at the biological level. And it affects us at many different levels, from the very molecular, such as DNA or proteins, all the way up to the level of the population. And so it's clear that the environment has many diverse effects on us, but it's also clear that the environment itself is quite diverse in its composition. And to put some numbers on this complexity, it's estimated that since the beginning of the chemical industry, we've released about 70,000 different types of chemicals in our environment. And to this long list, we add an extra 1,000 different compounds every single year. And it's not just a complexity in terms of number, it's also a complexity in terms of how we interact with our environment. Because what we're exposed to depends on where we work, where we live, what we consume, basically our general behavior. And so to really try to get at this complex relationship between our environment and our health, I believe we have to address the following four points. We have to identify what's the most detrimental to our health in our environment. We have to understand how this actually happens so we can better predict what other compounds might be toxic. And that once we build this knowledge base, then we can start thinking about educating the population about what we found, and also by communicating with governmental agencies and chemical industry, try to, again, as a society, regulate our output, what we produce and what we release into the environment. So addressing all four points is actually quite a daunting task, and I'll tell you what I did during my postdoc to really address the two first, identify and understand. And then by the end of my talk, I'll give you some ideas on how in the future I'd like to really try to address all four of these points. Okay, so in my presentation, there'll be three critical elements. There'll be the environment, there'll be us, and as a component of us, but I'll look at it a little bit separately, are our genes. And I'll look at the complex relationship between all three of these elements. Now, the way I decided to give this presentation is to first tell you two stories that are a little bit related to my research that I think will illustrate quite nicely the sort of challenges and the way that environmental scientists like to think about the environment. And there'll be some historical perspectives on the field, which I think will please some of you. And then what I'll do is jump into my research after those two stories. Okay, so the first story is actually what I think a very fascinating one, and I am really glad to have this sort of excuse to share it with you. It's the story of chimney sweepers in England, and there's this date here of 1775, which represents the date when, for the first time in history, there was a connection made between occupational exposure and cancer. So what you're exposed at work and cancer. And the story has to do, as I said, with chimney sweepers, and particularly in England, where there was a huge emphasis on trying to prevent fire, mostly because of the Great Fire of London in 1666. So you wanted to make sure that you kept your chimneys clean, you cleaned the flues very well. And it was also, if you look at the date, it was also the time of Industrial Revolution. So a lot of tall buildings, more chimneys, more flues to keep clean. So there was definitely an emphasis on the profession of chimney sweepers. Now, these chimney sweepers were usually children, as young sometimes as the age of four, but usually they would start working by the age of six. The reason why you needed children is because you had to be able to climb into these chimneys and go up the flues, and you may be able to see in these drawings actually the representation of three children climbing up the flues of these chimneys. I promise not to do this. And obviously you can imagine that the working conditions of these children was extremely dire. They would often get stuck in the flues, they would die by asphyxiation, and sometimes they would actually burn alive. And the last case of a child dying while doing this was actually a case of getting stuck and burning alive. If they somehow survived these working conditions, then they had another problem lurking around the corner, and in that these children very often developed first warts on the scrotum, and those warts very often again developed into cancer, and a specific type of cancer called squamous cell carcinoma, at a very young age, in their teens or early 20s. And there was no way of treating this cancer apart from very basic surgical removal. And they would actually die of a horrible death. Now, the way it actually happened is that these children, to be able to fit in the flues, would have to strip naked completely. And that's why their entire body, including the scrotum, would get exposed to high levels of the soot that was coating the walls, and that would develop into cancer. Now, the overall working conditions of these children actually led to the reconsideration of child labor laws in England, and that took the shape of the Chimney Sweepers Act of 1875. So again, it had an impact on society, and society responded to these environmental conditions that the children were exposed to. Now, I'd like just to point out the fact that it actually took 100 years between this initial connection and the Chimney Sweepers Act, and many people tried to pass acts before this, but they did not succeed, because it took 100 years to actually develop the technology to be able to clean the chimneys without requiring children. And once that became a possibility, then the Chimney Sweepers Act was able to pass. And I'd like to ask if we still have the equivalent of chimney sweepers today. So you would think about poor populations, working populations. You would imagine people that don't have a high level of education, who would desperately need a job, who are working in environmental conditions that are also quite challenging. And so I could think right away of two types of working populations. People work on farm fields, they're exposed to very high levels of pesticides, and this high level of pesticide exposure has been linked to great incidence of health problems, such as Parkinson's disease, which is something that actually people here at UCLA work on, this connection here. And I'll tell you later on during my research how I also look at pesticides, but in my case, the effects on reproduction. And then there are also other types of workers, such as landfill workers, who are exposed in their case to a variety of chemicals, not just pesticides. And this high exposure to a lot of different types of chemicals give them a high incidence of a lot of different types of health problems, from the skin, neurological system, etc., etc. And so, we're talking about a specific layer of the society here was affected. You're talking about usually illegal immigrants. It's extremely hard to be able to interview them. They're extremely wary about being interviewed in an official manner. They think it's immigration services in disguise, and so we really have no idea or very little knowledge of their needs and their concerns, whether they understand the risks associated with the profession, and therefore it's extremely hard to try to regulate working practices and implement changes so that you can make sure that they actually have a safe working environment. Okay, I'd like to switch to quite a different story here, but at least superficially will look like a different story. And this is the case of bisphenol A, and I'll tell you about the research that I did on bisphenol A later, so that's why I want to mention it here. So bisphenol A is a component of plastics, and what is interesting about this story is that it will also highlight how a specific layer of the society can be affected by a particular chemical. And I'll define what I mean by this layer later on. It won't be social economical, it will be another way of dividing the society. So bisphenol A, or BPA for short, as I said, is a component of plastic. This is what the molecule looks like. When you polymerize it, you can make a very common type of plastic called polycarbonate. And Nalgene bottles used to be made of polycarbonate. Now, Nalgene bottles, you know, the water bottles that you use for sports usually, are not made of bisphenol A anymore because BPA has been shown to have many adverse health effects. And I'm going to just show some of them. The first one is of great interest to me because this is what my research looks at. And BPA has been shown to increase the rate of aneuploidy. So aneuploidy refers to an abnormal number of chromosomes in a cell. And here, these two papers show that there's, in human, there's a great correlation between higher levels of BPA and abnormal number of chromosomes in the fetuses, which lead to miscarriages. So basically fertility problems in humans. Now BPA has, as I said, many different types of health effects, and I just want to point out another one that I think may be of interest to you. And this one correlates exposure to BPA with alteration of the epigenome. So the epigenome is the information that is layered upon the DNA that alters the way the DNA is interpreted and expressed. And so what you have here are actually five mice that are completely genetically identical. The only difference is the levels of BPA that they've been exposed to. So these mice here have received no to low BPA, and these mice here have received really high levels of BPA. And what this paper has nicely shown was that this high level of exposure to BPA changes the methylation pattern on the DNA, which leads to the alteration of the expression of the genes that control for the coat color. So there are other genes affected as well, but the one that is most easily seen here is the genes that control for coat color. So there's this also very nice correlation between BPA and epigenome, and I'll go back to the epigenome at the end of my talk.
Patrick, in this, is there any transgenerational effect? Do you know? Do you know if they have offspring? Do they actually?
So they're actually looking into it now. This person, she presented at a Gordon conference this summer, and they're now looking at multigenerational effects involving this.
Can I ask another contextual question? Why do people use BPA? Or not people, but why is BPA in plastic bottles if you can make plastic bottles without BPA?
Right, so it was actually the easiest way, at least at the time from what we knew, to make really hard, transparent plastics. It had great properties to make. So every time you see a really hard plastic, it's usually polycarbonate. So people use it in a plethora of different uses. Actually, lenses for glasses used to be made of BPA. It's probably still made of BPA. And I'll tell you about another usage of BPA later on. It's not just hard plastics, there are other types of plastics. It's just really easy to work with. So people now have been trying to switch to other types of plastics. The problem with these other types of plastics is that we actually don't know whether they also carry a health risk or not. So, which gives people like me jobs. So when I was talking about a layer of a society that is exposed, in this case it's not really a social economical layer, it's actually an age layer. So this is data from US Census, and you can see that the youngest age group, so 18 to 29, have from 1.5 to 3 times the levels of BPA in their urine than the oldest generation here, or oldest age group. And so this is the case in the US. This is actually the case around the world in many different countries. And we didn't really know why until this study came out from Japan. This study looked at university students, so young people, and they were able to correlate levels of BPA in the urine to the consumption of coffee and tea. So this A, B, C, and D refers to just increasing levels of consumption of coffee and tea per day. And so the more they consumed this coffee and tea, the more exposed to BPA they were. So people tried to understand why, and it turns out that in Japan, the way young people drink coffee or tea is often from like vending machines like this one. And you can see here, this coffee, I think that's tea, and it's actually kept hot in aluminum cans, just like soda cans, like the ones that we use for Coke, etc. And so the fact that this hot liquid was in this can actually helped BPA leach out of what turns out to be this lining inside of the cans that protects the aluminum from the liquid that is contained inside. And that gives a really high levels of exposure to the Japanese youth, but actually also in the US, although we don't drink hot liquids in our soda cans, we drink so much of the sodas, and the cans are also made with this lining, that also the young generations tend to be more exposed to BPA because they tend to drink more from soda cans. And I think this poses a really interesting question. We have young women and young men who are of reproductive age who are disproportionately exposed to bisphenol A. And so I'd like to ask the following questions. Well, does BPA exposure contribute to aneuploidies in specifically in women? I just showed you some papers that pointed that, you know, towards a yes, but we'd like to confirm that. And then if it does create aneuploidy, then how does it do it? And those questions are the sort of questions that I explored during my postdoc. Okay, so this is the outline of my research. I'd like to first tell you how I try to understand how chemicals interfere with our biology, specifically with our fertility. Then I'll tell you about the technologies that I've applied to identify what are the components in our environment that are detrimental to our health. And then by the end of my talk, I'll try to tie my research with or connect it with studies at the population level. Okay, so let's get started with the science here. So this is the human life cycle. It's made of two distinct stages. We have a diploid stage here, where we have two sets of each chromosome. And then we have a haploid stage, which is basically the female egg and the male sperm, so the gametes, where you only have one set of each chromosome. And by combining these two sets during fertilization, you go back to the diploid stage. Now, the opposite of fertilization, so to go from diploid to haploid, is the process of meiosis, where you have this really complex, intricate developmental program that reduces the number of chromosomes by half. And I'm very interested in examining this process of meiosis and understand how environmental factors can perturb this chromosome division reduction that takes place at this stage, and therefore lead to the production of gametes that have an abnormal number of chromosomes. Once again, something that is known as aneuploidy. And looking at examining this question is actually extremely challenging because, again, we have a complex environment, but also the process of meiosis and reproduction in general is actually a very complex biological program. And so examining the intersection of the two is actually, again, quite a daunting task. But this is what the field of toxicology is trying to tackle, these sort of questions. And the way toxicology is seen to go towards in the 21st century is to move away from using large animals, such as mice or rats, in some cases dogs or monkeys. There's definitely ethical issues with using species like this. But even if you still wanted to stick to mice or rats, you couldn't possibly screen tens of thousands of chemicals for a variety of different types of health effects in the time that we need. So to get a lot of data out of toxicity screenings, people have moved more and more towards cell-based type of assays, so using petri dishes instead of using whole animals. And those tests are great. You can definitely run a lot, get a lot of data out of them. But if you're interested in something like reproduction, well, you can't really do reproduction and meiosis in a petri dish. So what we need to get at a question are smaller animals that are simple enough to be used in large-scale studies for tens of thousands of compounds, but at the same time that are complex enough that they do reproduce and they do the process of meiosis. And so for the rest of my presentation, I'll tell you about the work that I did using this worm here, not an earthworm, called Cernodactylus elegans, or C. elegans for short, which is a great genetic model. Okay, so this is what the beast actually looks like. So it, again, it's C. elegans for short. It's about a millimeter long, so you need a microscope to really be able to work with it. And the first thing that you may notice is that the worm is actually transparent. So that allows you to visualize every single tissue, actually every single cell, every single nucleus within its body. And I'll even show you later on pictures of individual chromosomes later on. So the transparency of this animal is a tremendous advantage in the system. And you may actually be able to tell here that this is the germline here, and you have individual oocytes, I hope you can see those, that get fertilized here, and then you have the embryos right there in the uterus of the animal. So there are many advantages to using C. elegans. I've listed only some of them here. It has a short generation time of about 4 days, so it's great to look at multi-durational effects. The germline is huge in the animal. Half of the cells of the body are dedicated towards reproduction. So if you're interested in reproduction, it's a great system. It's small enough to be used in 96-well plate format, so that means large-scale studies. And in general, it's a very well-established genetic model, and in particular, it's a very well-established meiotic model for the study of meiosis. And that is only the case because there's a great degree of conservation of the genes and pathways that dictate not only meiosis, but also a plethora of physiological, cellular, and developmental processes. So we really wanted to mobilize the advantages of this elegant system and answer these environmental questions that we had. So the first part, in the first part, I'll tell you how I use C. elegans to try to understand how BPA can actually affect reproduction, and meiosis in particular. So I already told you why it would be interesting to look at BPA in the context of reproduction. It's highly prevalent in the environment. Its exposure, as I mentioned earlier, in human has been associated with negative health outcomes, including increasing aneuploidy. And what was seen in human was also seen in mouse models. So we know that in the mouse, during meiosis, we see aberrant chromosome morphology. Here you can see three different chromosomes that seem to be fused at the ends, and then you can see the presence of like what looks like a DNA fragment that seems to bud off from the rest of the chromosome. And then it also leads to chromosome segregation defects, and here you can see chromosomes that are aligned during this specific stage called metaphase, so they should be really aligned on what is called the metaphase plate here, but you can see that this pair of chromosomes failed to behave like the others and will likely be lost or randomly segregated during the next division. So we know that BPA caused these defects, but again, we didn't know how BPA could cause them. And we didn't know what genes and pathways were affected. And this is exactly what we set out to find using the worm. So this is a schematic representation of the worm germline and meiosis. And I won't really go into much details here, but what I did was to examine every single step of the process of meiosis, and every single pathway and substep within the process of meiosis that is important for the proper segregation of the chromosomes. And again, I won't really go into the details of each one of the stages, but I just want to tell you that and show you that very early on during meiosis, we see the presence of DNA fragmentation, just like what was seen in the mouse. And I hope you can appreciate this in this panel here, where you can see two germline nuclei, so one here, and I hope you can see those two DNA fragments here and here that seem to sort of bud off from the rest of the germline nucleus. And that's obviously not seen in the control. And I won't mention these panels, but just to say that there are other types of defects that we also see at this stage. So this was very early on during the process of meiosis, so we wondered if these same types of defects were also observed later on. So we looked in the oocyte that is about to get fertilized. So it's sort of the equivalent in human of the ovulated egg that the woman produced. And indeed, we saw strong defects. So again, this is the oocyte about to get fertilized. The chromosomes looked longer and thinner compared to the control chromosomes. And you can also see the presence of DNA fragments. So the resolution is not great here, but these two little dots here, actually fragments of DNA. We have 3D pictures to be able to visualize that properly. And this thread of DNA here also looks highly abnormal. It looks like it's about to get fragmented from the rest of the chromosomes.
Patrick, maybe I missed this, but what are the quantities that you're using in BPA here? Or are you doing your
Oh, right, so I actually skipped that whole part. So the amounts are about 2 parts per million, which is high, but which sadly is only one order of magnitude higher than the levels detected in placental tissues in human.
And is there a dose response curve that looks like a normal dose response curve? Or do
you talk like a true toxicologist.
Well, sorry.
No,
I'm learning.
It's actually not a U-shaped curve like some people observe. It's actually just a drop-off curve. It seems like this. It's actually not even a true drop-off curve. It's sort of like this. Mm-hmm. It looks like at the highest concentration that we could use in the media, suddenly fertility completely crashes. And we don't know why. You just don't have a true linear progression. It seems like between 0.5 and 1 millimolar external concentration, we have this huge drop-off in fertility, which can be completely rescued with cholesterol, but that's another issue, another side project. Okay, so as I said, these defects here were observed in the oocyte that was about to get fertilized. And so we assume that if you fertilize these oocytes that have such defective chromosomes, you should see chromosome segregation defects during embryogenesis. And that's exactly what we saw. If you look here at the bottom, those are one-cell embryos. We've used tricks here to label things around the cell. So the DNA is actually labeled in red. So those are the chromosomes. And in green is the apparatus that is used to segregate the chromosomes in the cell. And so if you just look at the red, I hope you can appreciate the fact that during metaphase, the chromosomes do not align nicely on the metaphase plate compared to control. So they form more of a bundle. And then during anaphase, instead of segregating nicely in two sets that will become the daughter cells, basically, you can see the presence of a DNA fragment or DNA thread that seems to be sheared between the two pools of segregating chromosomes. So this actually was taken through a process of live imaging, so we made movies, but my movie doesn't work, so I just tried it before. So I'll just skip to, actually, let me go back just a second, to tell you that what we've done so far is a nice replication of what had been seen in the mouse. So we saw chromosome segregation defects, we saw DNA fragmentation, so that was a nice way of using C. elegans to mimic what can be seen in mammals. But again, we wanted to go beyond this, and we wanted to provide molecular data, know what genes, what pathways were affected.
I have a question. Uh-huh. On that previous slide, when you say N equals 60, is that 60 oocytes from one organism, or is that 60 organisms, or the sample size?
The sample size is 60 individual embryos from multiple.
Multiple organisms.
I usually can only image one per animal.
Okay.
Okay, so I really want to get to the molecular level here and know what genes and what pathways were affected. And so, again, I won't really get into the detail, but I looked at the process of recombination, which is crucial for the process of meiosis. So recombination is the swapping of bits of chromosomes between your paternal chromosome and your maternal chromosome. And that really helps with chromosome segregation, but also, in general, helps with genetic diversity, just to mix DNA around. And so there are many pathways involved, or genes are involved in the process of recombination. Just to tell you that I looked at a lot of them and found that several of them seem to be affected in the expression when exposed to BPA. And those were involved in the invasion of the DNA between the two sets of chromosomes and also in responding to this invasion here. So basically, the bottom line of this slide is that we were able to find a molecular signature of exposure to BPA. So just to summarize, I just give you little snippets here of my studies, but just to summarize what I told you, we were able to recapitulate what we saw in mammals. We saw the presence of DNA fragmentation and chromosome segregation defects. And we're also able to provide a molecular signature of what's going on when exposed to BPA, and we saw that the process of recombination was actually dramatically altered And I won't go into the details of this. Okay, so I showed you that we can use C. elegans to try to understand how a chemical can affect meiosis and reproduction. Now I'd like to switch to the second part, which is how can we identify in our environment some chemicals that are detrimental to our health. And so I looked at fertility again, but also by the end I'll tell you about the work that I did to look at fat metabolism. And then again, I will try to make things relevant to the human population at the very end of my talk. Okay, so it turns out that it's very easy to detect aneuploidy in C. elegans because of features of its biology, once again. So what I didn't tell you is that the worms represented here are actually hermaphroditic. What that means is that they make sperm here and oocytes in each animal, and they actually self-fertilize. And at the chromosome levels, those worms are actually XX. So just like mammalian females, they have two X chromosomes. Now this is the case for the vast majority of the animals, but it turns out that if you have a defective process of meiosis, you will generate a very high rate of aneuploidy, and therefore you will generate a lot of embryos that will only have one chromosome instead of two, right? If you perturb meiosis, you'll have random chromosome segregation, and by chance, some embryos will only inherit one X chromosome instead of two. It turns out that in C. elegans, having one X chromosome equals being a male. And basically, males are therefore in the population a representation of aneuploidy. These males look different, they behave differently, and of course, they only have one X chromosome. So, this feature of C. elegans biology actually has been used to identify genes that are important for meiosis. And the way people have streamlined this process is to use this reporter strain that I'll describe. Called ZOL1-GFP. And so the way it works is that you have a fluorescent protein, a green fluorescent protein, that is under the control of a promoter that is only expressed in very early male embryos. So if you have a male embryo, basically your embryo will be glowing green. And I'll show you pictures of that later on. So what you can do in a genetic screen is create mutations. And if you created a mutation and disrupted the function of a gene that is important for meiosis, this worm will generate a lot of aneuploid embryos, and some of these embryos will only have one X, and therefore they'll express your green fluorescent protein. So whenever you see green X, that means aneuploidy, basically. And this is what it looks like. So again, the worm is transparent, so you can very easily visualize things inside of its body. So here you're actually looking at the uterus of the worm, and you have all these beautiful embryos here, and you have two of them that are clearly expressing your green fluorescent protein.
So, but there are other varieties of aneuploidy besides sex-specific.
Right. There are different types of aneuploidies. It's just that if your embryo is only inheriting one X, it will take on the male pathway and express this.
But there may be other kinds of aneuploidy that you're not picking up through this.
Right. But if you see an increase in the number of males, it's likely to represent an overall increase in the rate of aneuploidy. There are some differences in chromosome behavior between the X and the autosomes, the other chromosomes, the non-sex chromosomes, but usually it's been noticed that there's a fair correlation between, actually a very good correlation between increase in the rate of males and aneuploidy in general.
But is it conceivable that what's thought to be a mainly genetic sex determination strategy in C. elegans, we know it's the number of X chromosomes, the ratio of X chromosomes and autosomes that determine sex.
Yeah.
Like it is in mammals, for instance, different genetics, as opposed to environmental sex determination mechanisms, like it is in some insects, some alligators, some fish, etc. People have a tendency to separate environment and genetic sex determination as two completely separate things. But here, it could be conceivable that in fact in regular nature, not by experimentally adding some horrible compound, maybe it's a way to regulate sex determination and maybe it's a good thing.
So actually there's a lot of evolutionary biology that looks at this. It looks like, for example, when you have very little food resources, somehow, and we don't know how still, autism, I don't know how, that increases the rate of males. And so that might actually be a way to increase genetic diversity, maybe to be able to respond better to changes in the environment. So there's definitely some theories behind that. And to just finish with your question, one thing that people can also look at, besides the increase of male, is actually the increase in embryonic death. If you have not the proper set of chromosomes, you're likely to die. So what usually you do is screen first for the presence of males, and then look at how much of the progeny actually survives. And if you see a correlation in both embryonic death and rate of males, you know that this is a true representation of general aneuploidy.
Okay, I hope this is clear.
Okay, so what we wanted to do is employ the system and make it useful for a question. So we can take this reporter strain, expose it to toxicants, so environmental chemicals, and then look for the induction of green embryos. And again, this is what basically you can see under the microscope, a worm with a lot of green embryos inside of its body. And I just want to show you what I'm sort of working with. This is here a negative control, which is exposed to DMSO, the solvent in which you dissolve the chemicals. And I hope you can see some very faint embryos right here in the middle of the body, right there. And then this line here that goes throughout the entire length of the animal is actually the gut, which always has some fluorescence in the worm. It's sort of the caveat of the system, but it doesn't prevent you from actually looking at the embryos. And so here we have a positive control, which is a microtubule poison. So it's the apparatus that helps dividing the chromosomes. So if you perturb this apparatus, you will generate a lot of aneuploidy. And indeed, when you expose the worms to this drug, about a third of the worms show aneuploidy. So you basically see a lot of males. And for example, this worm here has three green embryos, one here, and one here. It's a black and white picture, but it's actually green in real life. So here, here, and here. So we can use the worm to look at chemical exposure and induction of aneuploidy. And so I won't get into the sort of validation steps, but I'll just tell you about the recent results that I've obtained screening environmental libraries that are available from the government. So I looked at this library here of chemicals that is mostly made of pesticides, and is made available by the Environmental Protection Agency. The reason why I decided to use this library was because these pesticides have actually been studied for an enormous amount of time now, and we have a lot of data in other systems on whether these chemicals cause reproductive problems and also have multi-generational problems as well. So what we can do is try to correlate my screen with what we already know in mammals, and hopefully we should see a good correlation between the two. So from this library, to start, I selected 60 compounds based on the outcome of 11 different types of tests that were indicative of a decreased fertility in females. And I divided the 60 compounds in three categories. The ones that were very reprotoxic, so caused strong decrease in fertility in females, in mammals, 20 that were mildly reprotoxic, and then 20 that were not reprotoxic, did not cause any sort of reproductive defects, as far as we could tell, in mammals. And what I was hoping, or hypothesized, was that the hits in our screen, so what's causing aneuploidy in the worm, should also be what's reprotoxic in mammals. So that would be a nice validation of the system. So just to show you how I did the screen, this is a 24-well plate. I put buffer in each well, the chemical, first at a concentration of 100 micromolar, some food for the worms. They feed on bacteria. They are very easy to feed. And then about 200 to 300 worms per well. And then I looked at the worms at two different times, which allow you to capture different events of meiosis. I won't get into that. And then I recorded the number of worms that had at least one green egg or embryo, fertilized egg, inside of their body. Okay, so this is what the data looks like. Let me orient you. So what you have here on the y-axis is the fold change over the negative control. So this line here, 1, represents no change. We have a line here, 2, which is right now the arbitrary cutoff or threshold that we set. So anything above 2 is right now called a positive, and anything below 2 is called a negative. We have a positive control here nicotrazole, and then we have the two types of compounds that I've looked at so far, the ones that are the most reprotoxic in mammals, in red, and then the ones that are the least reprotoxic, or not reprotoxic in mammals, in green. And I hope you can see that there's already a fair partitioning of the chemicals at 24 hours. The ones above are cut off, mostly the red ones, whereas the ones below the cutoff are mostly the green ones. So it's not perfect, but you know, it looks like it's dividing itself fairly well. Now, 65 hours, this partitioning is actually better. You can see that almost all the chemicals above 2 are the red ones, and almost all the chemicals below 2 are actually the green ones. So the ones that are not reprotoxic in mammals. And we have some internal controls here. We know we were very happy to see that BPA, which we know causes problems in aneuploidy, is actually quite a strong hit. And mancozeb and maneb also cause aneuploidy in mammals, also strong hits, and they're actually related chemicals, so it's good that both of them were above a cutoff. But there are also some exceptions, and I can't ignore the fact that the two strongest hits in that small screen were actually chemicals that are not supposed to be reprotoxic in mammals. So I was definitely not happy when I saw this, but then I did literature searches, and I can't explain norfloroxacin yet, but thiabendazole very quickly came up as actually a genuine hit, because people have known for a long time that injecting thiabendazole in male mice caused aneuploidy that you can detect in the sperm. So although EPA has ranked thiabendazole as not being reprotoxic for some reason, based both on the results from a test and simple literature search, it's very likely that thiabendazole caused a lot of aneuploidy and therefore is reprotoxic. And of course, future work will also look at norfloroxacin and the mechanism of action of those guys and how it disrupts meiosis and leads to aneuploidy. Okay, so to summarize this part, I told you that we employed a tool that detects the presence of aneuploid embryos. We can easily do this just by microscopy using fluorescence. And what we have in our hands is something that we think is reliable and relevant based on the tests that we've run so far. And just to let you know that I'm working now on improving this screening strategy to include tests that won't require microscopy. So you can imagine that if you have to screen thousands and thousands of worms, you don't want to sit at a microscope all day, you or your students. So what you want to have is literally something on a plate where you just put the plate in a machine and let the machine do all the counting, and this is exactly what I'm working on. And then once we've built this, I'm planning to screen large environmental libraries, and I just want to mention this one here, TOX21, which is it's a multi-governmental agency library that includes 10,000 compounds, so it's really getting now to the level of complexity and numbers that we want to have if we really want to understand things on a broad scale. Okay, in the last few slides, I'd like to tell you about some thoughts I had about future directions, either medium term or maybe long term. I'd like to also look at other types of health problems that could be caused by environmental exposure. Yeah?
Can I ask one question on the previous slide? So those toxicological libraries, you're basically talking about screening chemicals that there's never been the time to screen them with these mouse models and human and other models.
Right.
So we have these 70,000 compounds in the world, and what percentage of, or what number of them have been tested, and then, you know, what is...
So the last library that, at least I know, has been tested to various extent is this ToxCats, what's that problems with that? ToxCast phase 2, and this one is about 1,000 compounds.
And those are so you're still in the validation phase. You'd want to find similar results.
Right. So that, which is why I put it here. Those actually, this library here includes not only pesticides, but also drugs that failed approval by the FDA or during the different phases. So having those drugs actually is great because you get human data, not just mouse models as well. And this would still be the validation phase. TOX21 is just jumping into the ocean. It's like, let's just fish for whatever we can find after we've validated the system.
And then, maybe you're going to talk about this later, but can you give some estimates about like what kind of time, you know, so how many could you do in a relevant amount of time if so far in the previous models we've only been able to do 1,000? I mean, is this revolutionary? I mean, are you talking about you could do all 70,000 of these chemicals in 3 years or something?
Well, so there's no library that covers 70,000 chemicals. So the biggest library, which took, I think, about 10 years to make, is this 10,000 compounds. I had made this estimation, actually, I should have reviewed the number. We estimated, I think, a matter of 6 months to test for the 10,000 compounds. It's 6 months of intensive work.
Sure.
And
as opposed to it hasn't happened and never will.
Right, and to be fair, it's 6 months of machines doing the work on an almost continuous basis. So, I'm confident that I should be able to get those plate reading assays going. But those will be essential to really try to get at the 10,000 compounds and do them in a short period of time. So again, 10,000 compounds would be a matter of months. Tox class phase 2 would be a few weeks. I think a week and a half, I've calculated, if we have, those plate reading assays.
But this is stuff that, with mice, can almost not be, it's almost infinite
time. It can be done.
Right.
I removed a lot of introduction slides, but one thing that you have to keep in mind, or I think is important to know, actually, is the fact that in mice, it's easy to look at the later stages of meiosis, the ones that happen in adulthood, but it turns out in females, meiosis is sort of split into, and you have the early steps of meiosis that take place in the embryos, and then the later steps of meiosis that happen in adults. Mm-hmm. And so looking at meiosis as a whole, most of all the early embryonic stages, which are extremely hard to actually access, is something that makes it extremely hard mm-hmm. in females. In males, it's easier because it's sort of continuous. Right, so, yeah. I didn't jump on this because they existed. I jumped on this because we didn't have the technology and I wanted to develop the technology to look at this sort of questions. Okay, so beyond the germline, are other types of health problems that I'd like to address. One of them is what is called obesogens. So obesogens are chemicals that are supposed to make us fat. And there's some evidence now, more and more evidence actually in the literature, that they are chemicals in the environment that alter the way we metabolize our food and therefore fat. Obviously, diet is probably the primary cause, but there may be other things that play into this. It turns out that the worm, again, is a good model to look at obesity. One, because the pathways that regulate fat metabolism, triglyceride accumulation, are extremely well conserved throughout evolution. And then two, it's also easy using the worm to look for fat storage. So here you see a worm that's been fed a lot of bacteria. You can see that when you stain this worm with oil redo, you see a lot of dark red throughout the worm. Whereas this worm here that has been removed from its food for, I think it was about 24 hours, you can see that this worm has used a lot of its fat storage and the red staining is much fainter. So I always had this in mind, and it turns out that while screening for compounds that created aneuploidy, I realized that some of the worms looked really, really fat under the microscope. Mm-hmm. And so I stained them for fat storage using oil redo, and I saw that this particular compound here called pyrifos indeed made the worms very, very fat, as you can see here compared to the control situation, which was only exposed to DMSO. So right there in our hands, we have something that can be used both for inducing aneuploidy and therefore perturbing reproduction, but also for looking at the way the worms and likely mammals are metabolizing fat. Okay, I'm going to try to wrap it up quickly. The last part that I think would be very interesting to look in the future is the relationship between environment and the epigenome. And the different types of epigenetic modifications that can be layered upon the DNA information. You can modify the basis of DNA. You can also modify the histones and also create different landscapes in the genome. Some regions of the chromosome that have been repressed, some that will be expressed. And while I'll tell you what the worm is not good for, the worm is not good for looking at DNA methylation for the reason that this is a process that is only found in placental mammals. But the worm is really good for looking at those two events here, including histone modifications, which is extremely conserved throughout evolution from yeast all the way up to humans. And I think I want to leave some time for discussion, so I actually skip some of the data that we've actually generated in the lab, looking at enzymes that are important for modifying the histones, just to tell you that we actually found this protein here, SPR5, that is important for the worm to actually adapt to DNA damage, and when you remove this protein, the histone marks won't be removed properly, or the regulation of this histone marks won't be happening properly, and over several generations, you'll have progressive sterility. So ultimately, if you can't regulate your chromatin properly, you'll have sterility in response to exogenous DNA damage. Long story, I can tell you about it later. But, so what we want to do is, again, try to address a niche that has not been explored so far. So there's some work now looking at environmental regulations of epigenetic marks, but this work has only focused so far on DNA methylation. This is the mouse work that I've showed you before with BPA. And what we want to do is use C-ligands to, again, complete our understanding of this process and look at the environmental regulation of histone modifications. And so we can ask whether histone marks are affected by environmental exposures, whether the enzymes regulating those histone modifications are also affected, and whether we can see effects over one generation or maybe, hopefully, over several generations. Okay, so let's summarize the concepts that I've introduced today. I've told you that I'm interested in looking at the effects of the environment on a health. And to do that, I took a little bit of a detour. I used model systems to understand what's going on also at our level. And so I want to tell you in the next few points I'm planning to make this relevant to the human condition. Once, if we talk about the screen about aneuploidy, once we have a list of compounds that we know increase aneuploidy, then we can start looking at the level of these compounds in humans. And for example, in the IVF clinic, you could think about looking at the level of those aneugens, so compounds that cause aneuploidy, in the follicular fluid, which surrounds the oocyte. Once you do this, then you can, again, in the context of the IVF clinic, you can start making correlations between higher level of the compounds that we know cause aneuploidy with clinical outcome from IVF. Are the grades of the embryo good, and is the pregnancy successful or not when you correlate it with the high levels of this compound? And again, based on what we found, we can start making recommendations to patients in order to reduce the exposure. You may find that some, let's say, types of pesticides increase the rate of aneuploidy, and these people might be sensitive to it, so you may recommend that the patient stay away from farm fields or things like that. And then, ultimately, based on what you found, it would be very important to make recommendations to governmental agencies in terms of regulating the release of these chemicals. And I hope that you see that this really goes back to the first, to the what I introduced at first, which are those four points that are crucial to me: identify, understand, educate, and regulate. And so, I briefly would like to acknowledge the two mentors who give me all the freedom I needed to explore these questions, my collaborators at EPA and my two funding agencies, the two Colgate Palmolive grants I've been very happy to receive, and the NIHS K99R00. Okay, that was a lot of information. I'll be happy to answer any questions, detailed or general, if you have any. Thank you very much. So there's already a little bit of a debate on what the overall rate of aneuploidy is in humans. The rate in males seems to, I think we have a good assessment because it's easy to get the samples, obviously. So it seems to be hovering between 1 and 3%. In females, depending on where you get the data, you get a pretty, you know, a big difference in terms of numbers. In the IVF setting, it seems to be hovering around 20%, so a huge difference compared to the average male population outside of the epidemic community. So that's the number that we know in terms of increase. I think there's still, again, a lot of debate regarding the just the basic number. So I, yeah. And I actually don't know 100 years ago if we had the tools to really look at this on a broad scale, the N values. All right.
Thank you, this was so exciting. I want to just, it seems that, you know, you are alone there with your new system, which is not a mammoth system.
Yeah.
So I'm sure there will be other, you know, other such system being developed. So how does, so first of all, is it very competitive? Secondly, what is special it with your system? Because this, I mean, it's a long lead way, right?
Until
you are there and start doing all these exciting things you plan to do. So, can you tell us a bit about the context in which this happens?
Sure. So, let me go back to a slide that I think will illustrate your point quite nicely. So, there are the mammalian systems, and those, for sure, I mean, those, okay, so let me just show you this graph. This graph was made, actually, by these three people who are very big in the field of toxicology, and they really were pitching the what is called the toxicology in the 21st century, so this new approach of doing toxicology. What they say here is that as you're more on the left, you're going to have something that is more relevant to the human condition. So mice, rats are great because what you find there is very relevant. Now, most of the old toxicology use those models, and I have to admit there's a little bit of reluctance towards the new models. I think they just feel like maybe it won't be as relevant, so we're definitely going to have to prove that the system indeed is relevant. Also, you know, I mean, be fair, like, it's not always going to be relevant. There's going to be some inaccuracies, and you're just going to have to put some numbers and quantify this very, very clearly. Now, the field is not competitive right now, as it is. There are only a few labs using C. elegans. There are labs using Drosophila, so the fruit fly, and there are definitely more and more labs using zebrafish. Now, the reason why it's not really competitive right now is that each model actually has its strength. And so I would not use zebrafish to look at reproduction, because it's only the adult fish that would actually be sexually mature. And if you want to, and do meiosis. And so if you want to look at this, you would actually have to wait multiple months until you can get the fish that's actually doing meiosis. So, but it would be very useful to look at limb development, for example. So fin development in the fish is very, very similar to limb development in mammals. So you could use zebrafish for that. So I think each person so far specialized to different aspects in different models. And I don't think there's one model that could be good for everything. So in that sense, there's definitely a niche that I've been able to jump into right now. Does that answer your question?
So following up on Soraya's questions, I was just thinking, you know, if you've been exposed already during your talks or your writings to the increasing skepticism against science, against the EPA, you know, how do we know that all this is not a governmental plot to kill jobs of hardworking Americans who would have otherwise, you know,
these people have not reviewed my papers.
So, no, but seriously, so because one of the problems about the regulation things is you bring in a new model,
yeah.
And you know, as sort of, you know, well, why would we care,
yeah.
That something's toxic in the worm, whereas we're just.
And honestly, okay, so that's definitely something that I've heard before. I just want to mention actually a little bit of a story here, which is, so I did work on BPA. BPA is extremely controversial as a chemical. There's a lot of effects that have been shown, but the chemical industry, such as Dow, not to mention them, is really going strongly against, and definitely is putting in a lot of research showing that BPA at environmental levels does not necessarily have an effect. And so with time, what happened is you have two antagonistic families, the people who believe that BPA has an effect and the people who believe that BPA does not have an effect. And you get caught in the middle. I got caught in the middle of this. And yes, it's very easy for people to dismiss the work if it's not done in a Mermillon system. They definitely use that angle, and they actually, it was very interesting submitting a paper on bisphenol A because my reviewers were all over the spectrum, and they do not look at the science. They just look at their own beliefs and respond, not respond to what data you're generating, but respond to their own belief system. And your paper gets reviewed that way, which is extremely unscientific to me. But that's how my paper got reviewed in the first place. So yeah, there's a lot of controversy regarding this, and in toxicology you get caught in the middle of it, and the only way to get past this is to just generate very solid data, data that you can't be really argued against. What's really interesting about the field of toxicology and the Society of Toxicology meeting every year, though, is a good representation of that, is that it's really coming together of industry, academia, and governmental agencies. And you see the connection, the good old friends from industry and governmental agencies talking to each other. So there's a lot of political games that go on in that field that I think is very interesting and challenging at the same time.
Chris? So I've got two questions. One, hopefully, is easy, which is just explain to someone who's naive about these things why aneuploidy is a good representative of reproductive harm as opposed to just one of many possible harms that we could be looking for. So why pick on that as a general marker of reproductive danger. So maybe you can just say that quickly. But the other is actually related to what you were just talking about, which is, are there other fields that you could imagine collaborating with around these questions? And in particular, I'm thinking outside of the kinds of questions the toxicologist ask and more towards the kinds of questions chemical engineers ask, right? Mm-hmm. So BPA is BPA to toxicologists, but to chemical engineers, it's one of a hundred different ways of doing something, right? And so are there ways in which you can imagine this kind of system being useful to chemical engineers as they develop different synthesis recipes, for instance?
So maybe I'll start with that question first. I think the goal actually is to I don't want to use the term society too often, but indeed as a partnership, let's say, of academia, governmental agencies, industries, just all move together. And so it'd be very interesting to be able to have a system that is portable, a technology that many people can use, including have chemists work together with toxicologists so that they screen right away before releasing into the environment and finding out 15 years later or 20 years later down the line that it was actually not good for you. Have something in-house that people can actually use so that you can prevent the sort of problems down the line. It's sort of integration. Right now things are very compartmentalized. It's pretty clear in the field. And what I'm really trying to do is have something easy, portable, relevant. Mm-hmm. And we've put a patent on this, people have shown interest, BASF has shown interest in it, but they just want more proofs. Once we get this, then we can actually have something in-house that would just stop things, hopefully, very early on in the product chain.
Right. But there's actually a more complicated question beneath this, which is that the toxicological mindset is toxics, right? The question you're asking is, does this harm? And you define what harm is, and you test for that. The chemical engineer's question is, which one harms more or less, right? Like, what's the trade-off between this or that chemical in terms of economic efficiency, right? And so, in some ways, what you want is, and you're sort of halfway there with this system, is to actually be able to define for chemical engineers some of the mechanisms that these chemicals affect, right? Which is goes
well,
to
my
question.
And also see the effect in the first place, which actually will go back to your first point.
Yes, so that there can actually be rational decision-making about whether to choose one chemical or another based on something other than just economic efficiency.
Right, so I actually agree with what you're saying. I just want to say that I think, I don't know if when you're working at the human population, if you can really think about harming
more or less. Okay. I think if you affect 1% of the worms, nobody's going to cry over this. If you affect 1% of the human population, a lot of people would have problems with that. So I think ultimately, when you go back to the human population, things will become more black and white, and you can't just have gradations of things. You're going to have, at some point, a black and white system where you say, no, I can call this safe, 100%, at the levels that you're supposed to.
About this first question,
actually, sorry, can I go back to your first
question? Yes, first, can you just explain a little bit more the term itself, the aneuploidy?
So aneuploidy refers to an abnormal number of chromosomes. You can generate aneuploidies in different ways, during mitotic division, so just when regular cells divide, or during meiosis, so when the germ cells, so the oocyte or the sperm, are generated. You also have chromosome division that takes place there, and you can generate aneuploidies there. The reason why we are focused on aneuploidy right now is that, one, we don't have a good handle, a good tool to actually examine this. Second of all, just looking at the, let's say, mice, or even in human, the number of offspring may not be a fair representation of what hidden effects may actually be seen. And by hidden, I mean hidden at the time. You can imagine that if you have a compound that causes a lot of aneuploidy, you may have a lot of early on, actually, germ cell death. And maybe you'll have menopause taking place earlier, things like that. So you may not be able to see things externally, let's say, in human during reproductive age, but you may have consequences down the line as well. So I think aneuploidy is one thing that people have not been able to look at efficiently in females, and we think we can do in C. elegans, and it's maybe something representative of different types of problems.
There's a question over there.
Well, there's a question over there too. Okay. Go ahead.
Actually, I have two questions. One is that possible in the future studies for you to add more information such as a protein and the messenger RNA and the microRNA expression spectrums to provide a potential mechanism or the networks about the about the effects. Actually, you actually provide a successful in vitro model, to me much better than the in vivo cell test. But still, consider still in the environmental toxicology assessment, the disparity between the C. elegans and the human sapiens. Still a large disparity, and if you can prove the evidence, especially in those conservative pathways that both existing in human and in the C. elegans, maybe provide more stronger evidence for you to go through your argument.
Sure.
And the other one, the other question is about what about your plan to do the next stage epidemiology study to translate your results into the population level?
Right. So actually, that was the one of the last few slides that I had, and it was something very sort of quick in passing. So I'll go back to that. Definitely said exactly what I would like to do. So when I do the screening strategy, the next step after doing that is going down, once you find a candidate that seems to cause aneuploidy, is trying to understand how it causes aneuploidy. And this is where my talk was a little bit backwards, but once you do the screen, then you can do the same sort of analysis that I did for BPA and try to narrow down those molecular targets that then would be very easy or easier to look at in mammalian systems. And once you have this, then you have something that is that people will believe in and that people will deem relevant. Now, I don't want to negatively spin my entire work. It sounds like I'm fighting against a wall of non-believers. That's actually not true, and I've shown those results at meetings this summer. And there were many people from EPA, and they just love that kind of work, and they would love to integrate those sort of tests into the battery of tests that they have. And but again, working with pesticides, doing things gradually, working with pesticides where we know the mammalian effects, correlate things with the mammalian data, with getting down to those molecular targets, just like I did with BPA, will be essential to really establish the system very well. Now to go back to the epidemiological level, this is where when I was visiting the Environmental Health Science Department, it seemed like there was a great synergy there. The epidemiologists who have access to Beata Ritz, Dr. Beata Ritz, a great epidemiologist here, has a lot of access to the IVF clinics, and we already talked about looking at the correlation between what we can detect in follicular fluid and you know, pregnancy outcome. So there's definitely a connection there that we can make down the line.
Thank you for a really fascinating talk.
Thank you.
And we've chatted before, and I kind of just want to play with some of the information you presented earlier about how there's a rich literature coming out from Japan about the science, about BPA and
mm-hmm.
its effect on young people, as well as the more other kinds of studies. And I was curious to know how you relate your work to this set of literature that is from outside of the United States, outside of Europe. Do you see this as more of, you know, material for you to notice and work with? And then I know that you've also requested Cialogen samples from Japan. But I wonder if there's something more than that. Is this something that is going to remain localized to the culture that you're in, or is this something that you can see expand outwardly? I'm just shocked myself by how, having lived in Japan for a number of years, these vending machines are so ubiquitous. And it's also very, like, I've had to make conscious decisions myself to reduce the amount of plastic I come into contact
yeah.
with in Japan, and there's no mistake that there's something there, but I mean, I wonder how you're going to, how you envision taking us to
yeah.
Other cultures.
Well, people love to pop questions, and I always have problems remembering the two questions at the end. Okay, so the first part was about using data from Japan. This is something that I've actually done a lot. They were, at least, I think so, I think they were the first ones to actually use Cialogens to look at toxicological questions. So there's a great, I think, history and culture of innovation in Japan that I've definitely been able to tap into. They did some early work with actually BPA and DS and looked at things on a broader level than I did. In Cialogens and in other models. So I definitely was able to tap into this literature, and they keep on coming up with great stuff that I get inspired by, definitely. In terms of, does that answer?
Yeah, and I was also curious, I mean, is Cialogens the only model system used in Japan? Are there other models, or is this the organism that represents the Japanese toxicology or Japanese studies?
No, it doesn't. I don't think it represents toxicology as a field in actually in any country. It's still one of those emerging models that people are starting to jump on now. And I think the Japanese were just the first ones to actually do this. Now there's actually, within the National Toxicology Program, now there's actually a Cialogens group that we're collaborating with. Who is not looking at exactly the same things that we do, but you know, now there's actually things here in the U.S. that people are, where people look at the same sort of questions, or using the same sort of models, I should say. Your second question, right, so right now things are definitely dependent on, or related to what is available through the governmental agencies in terms of the chemicals that we look at in the libraries. Well, those were made by governmental agencies. The way the chemicals were selected were based on different type of things, but ultimately it's what's found most commonly in the US. It's differently US-centric. Now, when you reach 10,000 compounds, though, you will definitely get a little bit more about, more into the global side of things, because you'll definitely cover a wide range of chemicals that will be found in other countries as well. And I think, ultimately, what will be very interesting is sort of the point that I tried to make at the beginning is, well, these compounds will likely be found in a lot of different places, but how do certain population get exposed to these compounds? How, what kind of consumption behavior, or behavior in general, makes us more exposed to some of them versus others? And that will be very interesting to see, again, how consumption behavior of soda cans in Japan may make them more exposed to some types of chemical versus us, or older populations who tend to drink from teacups and things like that. So those sort of studies will be interesting to, yeah, to definitely look at how our behavior makes us interact differently with, and culture will make us interact differently with our environment.
So I wanted to sort of follow up on Chris's question about regulation. And the first thing is, I think that Chris is right I'm in public policy, and there's a lot of, you know, cost-benefit trade-off doing worse, you know, what is the value of a life? And then, you know, how much would it cost to do this regulation? You know, we all know that dirty air is bad for us. There's no question there, but the question is how much does it cost to regulate it versus how many lives you save? And so there's a lot of that trading off done in policy making. But so that makes me think about this in terms of the question of heterogeneity, which you didn't really address. So I assume that the worms you're dealing with are clones.
Yes, it's a homogeneous population.
Right, so it's not genetic heterogeneity, which is the reason that 30% of the worms are affected and 70 are not. And so one question is, what are the sources of heterogeneity? And then how do you think about heterogeneity in response in a human population? Because one possibility would be, say, if it's pesticides in some field, say, okay, let's get rid of this pesticide because 1 in 10 farm workers are going to get cancer or have, you know, one of these aneuploidies and it'll be bad. Another would be to say, let's do a genetic test or some other kind of test on these individuals and screen them out of the farm worker population and discriminate rationally and just let the people who won't be affected work with the pesticides and bump up the pesticides. So how do you think about
the pesticides?
Well, or, you know, whatever, if it's not going to hurt them, why not? I mean, it's like the Roundup solution, right? It's the same thing you do.
Yeah, we could also debate about that. Yeah. I love the question. That's a great question. Okay, I completely agree with you. I may not be able to get directly to the question of heterogeneity with the worms, because the worms, by nature, they're clonal, so it's a homogeneous population. However, again, once you have the molecular targets, once you know what is the molecular signature of the pathways that are affected, then you can actually look at this in the context of the human population. With the knowledge of a chemical affecting a pathway, also, I mean, there's still a background literature of how this chemical is processed by the body, what kind of enzymes will activate or deactivate it, etc. So once you know that this is indeed not good for you, then you can actually start using both the mechanistic insight that I would provide, as well as the background literature, to find out how the genes that process this this chemical to activate it or deactivate it, and the downstream effectors are variating in the population. How they vary in the population. I think that will eventually get to that diversity of the human population.
But you could possibly introduce in the animal models some genetic variants that you observe in
so
the
are there strain
differences? Right.
So people have thank you. That's a question I actually get often. And I haven't done yet, but there's definitely screens that are possible for increased sensitivity or decreased sensitivity to chemicals. Definitely, yeah.
Maybe one last question, sorry.
Definitely. Many other questions.
Right. We also meeting tomorrow, right?
You'll have your time.
If there's someone else.
Yeah. No, go ahead, because we're going to wrap up.
I mean, you know, historically, you started with the chimney. So we know about these relations for a long time, but now historically, there has been very little money. I think 1% or 99% of funding in finding, for instance, cures for chemicals that would be drugs for cancer instead of looking at these connections. Yeah? So very bad funding pattern.
Uh-huh.
So I mean, the question then comes: so you know, and you depend on funding, right? You want to, so do you think that there is just now a moment where there is that is good for this kind of research? You see what I mean?
Right,
I mean,
have that historical perspective to understand.
So why
to,
now
to know
this?
To look at.
And is there really a chance to move forward with this, or will you sort of be staved off because all these, you know, different interests that you mentioned are actually not interested in your work?
Right.
Because you can mess up things or make things difficult for them. So, so this would be one thing, and the other one, which you may answer or not answer. But you know, if you you know you're interested sort of in this context of the center, and so what do you think you know our sort of science policy, sociology, anthropology, history kinds of context could sort of you know add to your work or you know shape it or do you like to be sort of you know get these questions from outside this, your narrow field? And
this
so
is the liveliest conversation that I've had in a very long time about my work, and actually I really like this sort of outside input. I think the communicating, working with people in the center will be actually essential for me to be able to tackle the last two points of education and regulation, which is something that actually, I should mention, the Environmental Health Science Center is also extremely keen on. So I think there's definitely a synergy between where I could potentially get the two half FTEs to really work together to really try to address not just the tiny little mechanistic part of, okay, this gene is affected, I'm done, no, but really try to cover a broader spectrum and look at things from different perspectives. About the historical perspective on thing, toxicology is a relatively new field, and I don't think people have had, there are a few stories like this, but I don't think people have had enough, you know, they haven't stepped back enough to look at it. When you read Silent Spring, though, I know it's, you know, probably overused as an example, but just looking at how our behavior, and our relationship with chemicals, I think is incredibly interesting, and just thinking that we didn't think much at the time, and we just spread, you know, pesticides all over houses and gardens from planes is absolutely, you know, terrifying. And our relationship, our views of our environment has tremendously changed, but I don't think we appreciate that enough. And whenever I give a general lecture on toxicology, I like to start with examples like that because it really shows us the leap that we've made on and our perception on our environment.
Great. Well, thanks for this very exciting.